been hidden away. Yes. I thought it was silly. They were just stuck on a window ledge. It's not practical to make them. They're so high up. But at least they should be on display because they're there. It's a marking memory of somebody, you know. So when I was climbing up to put the cross back on,
I think that's good.
Oh, good. I want myself a small tick.
Oh, I think you go to start.
It would be nice to light them, but it's... I do that without burning yourself. That's what we've taken this for, Bob.
Very warm welcome. Happy Easter, everybody.
Happy Easter.
Good to see you all. I hope you've had a good Easter so far. Had an amazing Holy Week. And I'm still just about awake. So we'll see what happens this morning. It's been absolutely glorious. And thank you to everybody who's managed to make some of the different things that have been going on. Something out of what's been going on. So I'm just going to read the bands of marriage. Official bands of marriage between Finlay William Kell and Ruby Elena Otley of this parish. And it's for their second time of asking. And if any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. A healthy silence. We pray for Finlay and Ruby. We ask for your blessing on their marriage and their life together. May they be surrounded by your love through life's ups and downs. And give them the strength to fulfill their marriage vows and live a life of love. Amen. Wonderful Easter hymns today, so please stand if you're able for Christ the Lord is risen today.
Thank you.
the Saviour shines upon you.
Let this church resound with joy, echoing the mighty song of all God's people.
Please sit or kneel for your prayer, for our prayers of penitence. Before we begin, before we have our prayers, I'm going to light our paschal candle for the first time. So, at 6 this morning, we had a bonfire at the rectory. There's about 12 of us gathered, and we said some prayers, and from that bonfire, as the door came up, the birds were singing, and the cat jumped on someone's lap as usual in our house, meowing way too loudly while I was praying. While all that was going on, we lit a candle and took it in a lantern to St. Mary's in Kippax. And from that we lit the paschal candle, took that into church, and from that we lit our benefice council, candle, and one has gone to Swillington, and one has come here. We are one in Christ, and it's lovely to share that community and share that light. So from that paschal candle, we light our own paschal candle for one single light of the dawn of the rising of Christ this morning. So I'm going to try and do it without setting light to myself.
There's a taper in the top of the snuffer.
Great direction from Martin there. Is ready. Theological College 101 feels like candles. It's quite difficult with this one. Excuse me, I'm a little bit. Christ's light shine in our hearts and it shines in this church. We may know God's light in our lives this year for our joys and for our troubles. May Christ be with us always. Amen.
Amen.
Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life.
Thank you.
through the mighty resurrection of the Son, overcame the old order of sin and death, to make all things new in him. Grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. Please sit for our readings.
First reading is from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. At that time, says the Lord, I will be the God of all the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus says the Lord, the people who survived the sword found grace in the wilderness when Israel sought for rest. The Lord appeared to him from far away. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. Again, I will build you, and you shall be built, O virgin Israel. Again, you shall take your tambourines and go forth in the dance of the merrymakers. Again, you shall plant vineyards on the mountains of Samaria. The planters shall plant and shall enjoy the fruit. For there shall be a day when sentinels will call in the hill country of Ephraim, come, let us go up to Zion, to the Lord our God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Then a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter began to speak to those assembled in the house of Cornelius. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him does what is right and is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread through Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear. Not to all people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
O Lord.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised. As he said, come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly, with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please take a seat. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
It's been a stunning Holy Week. Thank you to everyone who's been able to take part, and a big thank you to our confirmation candidates. That's right, Richard, Melanie, Samantha, Chloe and Eve all made their confirmation last night in the absolute splendour of Ripon Cathedral, with a choir of about 60 people. Magnificent organ and a full cathedral. It was absolutely splendid. A wonderful, wonderful evening. And it was great to share with them in that occasion. And Bishop Nick preached, and one thing he said was that we should encourage one another. Well, I have certainly been encouraged this week, not only by the folk nailing their faith to the mast, which is a term, a phrase that Bishop Nick used, but also in the faithfulness and example of those of us who've been on this journey for a much longer time. Some considerably longer. Try not to catch anyone's eye when I look around. Thank you, faithful and good servants. Several memories have stayed with me this Holy Week, which I'd like to share with you, especially if you are unable to make it yourself, so that you too can benefit from what we've been through. We began with Stations of the Cross at Swillington. Martin and Trudy used art and stories from different characters who knew Jesus, suddenly less than their own characters, to help us realise the impact Jesus had on so many people. And they drew this whole life into the meaning of his last few hours of his time on earth. For me, it was the realisation that we can never know the influence or impact of our faith and life on others. The way we encourage others and touch their lives with our faith is often hidden from us. On Wednesday, we walked with Jesus the path into the very and ever deeper darkness of our tenebrae service at Kippax. As each candle was extinguished, the darkness thickened until all was dark. The return of the light and loud clapping was a reminder that our darkness, that after darkness comes the touch of God's light. We also managed to drop one of the symbols, which is quite funny. If you look back on the video, you can see my face of horror. The handle came off. Maundy Thursday, Allerton was led by Gordon, and we entered into Jesus' Last Supper. It was here. And his command to love one another as we are loved by God. The foot washing as a symbol of our love and service to others was brilliantly brought to life by Gordon as we contemplated the shock of the dinner host doing the work of a slave in washing guests' feet. On Friday, we carried the cross through the streets of Kippax, and I was drawn back to Jesus doing the same in the ordinariness of his situation, especially as I stepped over some dog poo and people pushed past me in a hurry. The extraordinary in the ordinary, joy and grief and the highs and catastrophes of life jarring against one another in the mundane. Friday we had two sets of meditations. At 7 o'clock we venerated the cross at Swillington and received previously consecrated sacrament from our Maundy Thursday communion. Sharing in the veneration brought home the shared and hidden suffering that we endure and that is endured in the world. Christ touches us through his suffering, and we too touch the divine through the horror of the cross. While preparing for Friday's service, I had to bring the bread and wine from here, from Allerton, to Swillington. And I had a tinge of guilt, and I felt a little bit like a gangster. I had to put Jesus in the boot of my car. I felt complicit in his abduction and murder as I bundled him into the darkness of the boot. And then, of course, this morning, finally the light coming up and the mind-boggling meeting of the risen Lord, so otherworldly and earthy at the same time. Just like Jesus in my car boot, and shoppers squeezing past me as I carried a crucifix through Kippax, the real physical adoration of the cross, and the real bonfire this morning. These are like the women holding Jesus' feet. They are real physical details. They stop us purely spiritualizing the resurrection. It's real, folks, real stuff. And it's the touch of Jesus that brings healing and wholeness, not as an end in itself, but in neutrality with God's suffering and his desire for a relationship with us. For surely the strongest love language is touch. Of course, real love is shown through the unforced, compassionate touch of another, not wanting anything but comfort and wholeness for the other person. It is not conditional on the receiver's worthiness or state of mind. It's a gift freely offered and freely received, if so desired. It was during Maundy Thursday service with Gordon that I was struck by the joy and relief of my own emptiness. As we stripped the church of its symbols and religious stuff, we were brought back to the desolation of the cross and the comfort that can be found in that stark and simple place. With the many controversies surrounding us, with the false presumption to take a stance or to tweet an opinion, it's been a relief to step into the emptiness of this Holy Week, to face the stark reality that without the resurrection, our hope is small. And certainly not enough to do any good. That Jesus' suffering, death and resurrection are not, as Bishop Nick reminded us last night, an escape from the world, but throw us defiantly into the world, to fight the darkness, to live life as resistance. And yes, the hope is not about me, or by your powers, Instead, it's a mirror of Jesus' death that reveals the world as it is, in need of love and of healing. The Christian hope is not a fairy tale, but gritty and messy, and needing encouragement and forgiveness as we fail and then get up again. We are not defined by our failure, but by the identity of the one who loves us enough to come back from the dead and save us. Yesterday, we made this chasuble at Messy Church, you might have guessed. The hall was buzzing with children and families while Jesus lay in his tomb on Holy Saturday. And in our Gospel, suddenly Jesus met the Marys. How many times have we looked failure, loss and death in the face, as they must have, and thought, that's it, it's over, there's no going on. Well, for me, it's many times, and I'm sure it is for you. So here in our reading, the women that loved Jesus, who had lost their love to death, well, they meet him alive. They come to him and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Jesus wants the same for us today. He does not define us by our failures. He walks right through the mess, failure and disappointment, the whole Holy Week shebang, even death. And he says, I have walked this way too. Last night, our five confirmation candidates with a full cathedral reaffirmed their baptism vows, just as we are about to do. They have joined an act of defiance against a world that wishes us to be cold, to give up on love, and to have no hope. This morning we echo the words of Jesus in our Gospel. Do not be afraid. Be defiant. Live resurrected lives of hope. Reach out and touch the risen Jesus. Hold his feet. And through your tears of joy and wonder, worship him so he can touch you with new life and defiance in the face of darkness. Amen.
Amen.
Hope you like it.
Not quite humbly.
I'm going to take it off because it's a bit hot. Please stand if you are able. We're going to renew our baptism vows, those vows that were said for us or that we've said for ourselves at confirmation. In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his light, into his marvellous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. Therefore, I ask, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God?
I reject him.
Do you renounce the deceit and corruption of evil?
I renounce them.
Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and our neighbor?
I repent of them.
Do you turn to Christ as Savior?
I turn to Christ.
Do you submit to Christ as Lord?
I come to Christ.
Come to Christ, the way, the truth, and the life.
I submit to Christ.
May Almighty God, who has given you the desire to follow Christ, give you the strength to continue in that way.
Amen.
Amen. what's coming. Heavenly Father, bless this water, that whoever has washed in it may be made one with Christ in the fellowship of your church. Be brought through every tribulation to share the risen life that is ours in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So, I'm going to sprinkle you before I put it on the organ. Or the projector. Oh, hello at home. There you go, you're wet at home as well. Very wise sitting over there, I saw you. Just by way of a blessing. Just so I let you know. Sorry. Don't get wet. Bless you all. The wetter you are, the less you are. Smiling in the I'm not done with Christmas. Jesus Christ. Do you believe in trusting God the Father, the source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe in trusting God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us and rose again?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe in trusting God, the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world?
I believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Please take a seat.
This morning, we have a different response, an Easter giving response. You died and rose for us. And then the response is, we pledge our lives to you. You died and rose for us.
We pledge our lives to you.
As we rejoice in the surprise of Easter morning, we bring our prayers to our living Saviour, asking him to make his life-changing presence known in the world. Lord of life and hope, you made us an Alleluia people. So filled with Easter joy, we bring ourselves and all the people of the world to you. You died and rose for us.
We pledge our lives to you.
We live in a world that needs light and hope. May all religious people be instruments of peace and joy. We pray for governments and leaders, where they seek to work in their own strength, may the power of Christ's resurrection turn them towards his truth. May those people forget war and work for peace. You died and rose for us.
We pledge our lives to you.
For all those who live in situations of poverty, violence, powers of Good Friday. May they discover a new life of Easter, so that the darkness which surrounds them may be transformed into light. We pray for the church across the world. May it know the hope of resurrection. May we, like Mary, see the Lord and renew our faith. You died and rose for us.
We pledge our lives to you.
We pray for all of the people of the benefice, the diocese, and those people who were confirmed yesterday, especially Chloe. As they start their new journey through life, may each day draw them into a deeper and closer relationship with our risen Lord. You died and rose for us.
We pledge our lives to you.
We pray for those people who are weighed down with sickness or despair. May they encounter Christ in a new and surprising way. May they find courage to follow his path wherever that might lead. And we pray for all of those who are sick, especially those who are known to us and whom we name now. We think of Echo and Kathy H. Pray for Dorothy, Catherine and Claude Jaden, Wolf Lazenby, Colin Roberts, and people here who are perhaps not as well as they would like to be, but may not want their names mentioned this morning. And for those who are experiencing the pain of bereavement, it can be difficult to celebrate. May they find the comfort and support they need. May the ones who died be enjoying the fullness of everlasting life. We've had so many people in this church or connected to this church who've died recently. 10 of them in the last month. So this morning, we'll only mention a few of them. We think of Doug, of Dennis Hogg, of Lucy Knapp Jr., of Colin Flemings, and June Robinson, Sydney Bennett, Barry Rushwood, Stephen Faulkner, and Kathleen Thorpe, Marion Pine, and Alan Russell. We long for the resurrection to be a reality in our lives. Risen Lord, be our life, our hope, and our joy, and set our hearts on fire with love and Easter joy. You died and rose for us.
We pledge our lives to you.
May we trust God that we are exactly where we are meant to be. May we not forget the infinite possibilities that are born of faith. May we use those gifts that we have received and pass on the love that has been given to us. May we be confident knowing that we are children of God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us today and always.
Amen. Amen. Please stand up. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad and they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you. Alleluia.
Let's share a sign of that peace.
What's the word?
Thanks to the Lord our God.
it is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. In these days of Easter, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell, and restored to men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise, and opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so, in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. His perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world. rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. And as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen, and come among us.
We recognize him in the breaking of bread. Alleluia.
Thank you. Angels in bright raiment.
also with you.
The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and all you love always.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah! Hallelujah!